Welcome to TAB Virtual, the online broadcast of Sunday morning service at the historic Tabernacle Baptist Church in West Palm Beach, Florida. Our pastor is the Reverend Gerald T. Kisner, and our assistant pastor is the Reverend Kevin L. Jones. Chose to worship with us today, and we invite you to subscribe to our YouTube channel. If you are in search of a church home, Pastor Kisner and the members of Tabernacle would love to have you become part of our Tabernacle family. The historic Tabernacle Baptist Church, for over 127 years, we are God's church on the hill, serving Christ. Join us now as we offer our highest praise and worship to God.
He's blessing me,
over and over.
He's blessing me, right here where I stand, every time. Oh, he's making a way over and over. Oh, he's blessing me over and over. He's blessing me right here. Every time he's making a way somehow. Over and over again, he's blessing me. The Lord is blessing me right now. The Lord is blessing me, he's making a way somehow. You might not be able to see just what the Lord is doing for me. Over and over again, he's blessing me. Over and over, he's blessing me. Right here where I stand. Oh, every time. Lord have mercy, he's making a way somehow. Over and over. He's in my walk. Oh yes, the Lord is blessing me. He's in my talk. Oh yes, the Lord is blessing me. He's in my heart. He's in my soul. From the crown of my head to the tip of my toes. And over again, he's blessing me. Oh, he's in my walk.
He's in my heart.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes, the Lord is blessing me.
He's in my talk.
He's in my talk.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes, the Lord is blessing me.
He's in my mind.
He's in my mind.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes, the Lord is blessing me.
He's in my soul.
He's in my soul.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes, the Lord is blessing me.
He's in my heart.
He's in my heart.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes, the Lord is blessing me.
And every time.
Every time I turn around.
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 Every time. Lord have mercy, he's making a way some over and over. Over and over,
over and over,
over and over,
over and over again,
he's blessing me.
Good morning, good morning. We welcome you to TAB Virtual, our online worship service here at Tabernacle Baptist Church on this second Sunday in July. Amen. Amen. God is truly worthy to be praised. To our visitors, we welcome you. We know you had other opportunities that you could have exercised, but we believe that the Holy Spirit led you here to Tabernacle. So we pray that you will worship as the Lord leads you. And if you do not have a church home, we sincerely pray you'll consider Tabernacle at the end of this service. And to our church family, as always, we love you. We miss you. We thank God for you. And we're just glad to be able to worship collectively one more time. So if you are now, please join me for our call to worship. I will listen to what God, the Lord, will say. He promises peace to his people, his saints, but let them not return to folly. Surely his salvation is near those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land. Love and faithfulness meet together. Righteousness and peace kiss each other. Faithfulness springs forth from the earth, and righteousness looks down from heaven. The Lord will indeed give what is good, and our land will yield its harvest. Righteousness goes before him and prepares the way for his steps. Amen.
Good morning again. Good morning. My brothers and sisters, it is indeed a pleasure to be in the house of the Lord one more time. We're just so happy to be with all of you on this second Sunday in the month of July. All right, won't you please join me in prayer? Oh, Spirit, Spirit of the living God, please, please now fall afresh upon this service. God, you know that you are welcome in this place, but we want you to know that we acknowledge you, we exalt you, and we adore you. Thank you, God, for allowing us one more time to be in your presence. We pray, Lord, that you would anoint anew and afresh all that is done on this day. Touch the singing, the praying, the giving, and the preaching, all to the end that someone today who's feeling down and out might be encouraged and lifted up. Oh God, be with the stranger in our midst. Be with that person that may be shouldering a burden. And God, we ask that you would take it away, or God, give them the strength to bear it. Oh, Lord, we need you every day in every way. And we just are so elated that you've allowed us this opportunity. Oh, God, hear us now today. We lift up this prayer in Jesus' name. Let all of God's children say, amen.
Take the
My brothers and sisters, wasn't that a wonderful selection? Let's give them a nice round of applause. Amen. Well, here we are on the second Sunday in the month of July. And one of the things that I believe is upon the minds and the hearts of all of us is this bugaboo called worry. And I want to just talk about, I'm going to try to talk about the ineffectiveness of worry. The ineffectiveness of worry. I think, my brothers and sisters, that all of us would agree, as we look around the political arena, as we look around the sociological arena, as we look in our own personal life, even when we look in the household of faith, there are a number of things that would cause us to worry. Those musicians, Bobby McFerrin, had a popular song entitled, "Don't Worry, Be Happy." Don't worry, be happy. And there was a very catchy video that accompanied that song. Everybody was bouncing around and dancing, and the refrain was, "Don't worry, be happy." And who can forget Brother Pharrell Williams, who hails from your home state, Reverend Jones? He had the song called "Be Happy." And you could hear the refrain, and it was bouncy and peppy, and it encouraged all of us to be happy. Had a great beat. Y'all would be dancing up and down on that bad boy if we were playing it right now. But the songs, both of them, just held up a notion of being happy and not worrying. And to give a sense of encouragement. And I know that all of us who heard both of these songs probably thought on the innermost side of our spirit, what are they talking about? For to worry seems to just be endemic to the human character. There seems to be this sense of worry all around us. And I don't care how many songs you hear, I don't care how many tunes and how upbeat and catchy they are. There's someone right now under the sound of my voice that is worrying. We see it on every hand. Worry is so, as I say, endemic to the human condition that everyone walking around is probably worrying about something. We worry about whether we will be able to maybe pay the mortgage right now in these difficult economic times. We worry, will I have a job with the layoffs that have been part of the pandemic? We worry every time we send our children out and wonder, will they return home safely? We worry if we'll be able to continue to get up every day and work. We worry even in the midst of a governor that continues to tell us that the pandemic is over, and yet we have a new variant called Delta that has taken the United Kingdom by storm, and it's even in Florida right now. And we worry that even if we are vaccinated, can we not still get this dreaded virus? I say, my brothers and sisters, there's so many things that all of us worry about. We worry, will we be in a car accident with the way the crazy drivers on I-95 are? We worry, you women and men too, will I find love in my life, particularly in my older years? Will I find a companion that I can stay with on a permanent basis? And many of us worry as we get into the senior years of our lives. Will we make it another year? Are we right around the corner? Is death knocking on our door? When we see our brothers and our sisters that we may have gone to school with dropping, some by natural causes, others by illnesses, we wonder, will we be healthy in our senior years? And if we make it in our senior years, will we have enough money to make it? Can we buy groceries? We worry, will we have the means to continue to live a life of friendship and fellowship? Oh, my brothers and sisters, I'm sure there are so many other things I could throw out in terms of how we worry. Those of us of the darker hue, at night we wonder if a policeman stops us, will we be shot? Will we get arrested because of driving while black? And then those of us who have been fortunate enough to have a place to lay down every night, we worry if we'll lose our house and maybe in our senior years, we will be homeless. I say there's so many things that attack us on the right and on the left that cause us to worry. Now, my friends, there's a great tragedy. There's an ineffectiveness in worrying. Worry will cause you to get sick. I believe if we look at the medical reports, we'll find that it's already been determined that worrying, excessive worrying, can cause heart problems. Excessive worrying can cause you to not eat the way you should. Excessive worrying can cause you not to sleep at night. Worrying can cause the insides of your immune system to break down. Now, I'm not talking about theories. This is medical science. Worrying can cause you to begin to live out in toxic ways. For when you worry, you try to salve your worrying by acting out in ways that may not necessarily be healthy for you. You might drink too much liquor. You might eat too much food. You might engage in reckless sexual behavior. You might do all kind of manner of things because the worrying has caused you to act outside of your common sense. Oh, I know there's some witnesses in the house. Worrying will cause all manner of disengagement. For if you worry too much, you're not really very sociable. If you're always a worry wart, you can't see your blessings for your sadness. If you worry all the time, you're not really a good company. If you're worrying, I say it can lead to all manner of health problems. It can cause you to become depressed. Worrying, I'm telling you, my brothers and sisters, can cause you to even move into that dangerous area of suicidal thoughts. Now, to be sure, some folk will say a little anxiety is not too bad. For if you're anxious about a job interview, it might cause you to really be prepared for the interview. Yeah. If you have a little bit of anxiety about an examination that you're about to take, it might cause you to really study a little harder. When you feel like goofing off, that anxiety might force you to study a little harder. I'm not talking about that good kind of stress, that little bit that puts you up on your game, that heightens you. Athletes will tell you that before a game, they might worry of how they're going to perform, and that causes them to be more alert. No. I'm talking about that deep-seated worry that causes you to stay up late at night, that causes you not to have a good sleep. I'm talking about worrying that is ineffective in terms of handling your business. Yeah. One of the things, my brothers and sisters, is that in our worrying, we find that often the thing that we've been worrying about usually does not come to pass. And even if it does come to pass, all your worrying will not be effective in handling your situation. Oh, I'm trying to help someone today who is on the threshold of throwing in the towel, who on the threshold of doing something silly, something stupid, because you've been worrying about a situation that you don't have any control over. I started off by saying that part of our human condition is to worry. And I believe that part of that comes from not having any kind of faith in the God that woke all of us up this morning, the God that'll make a way out of no way, the God that is able to wipe all our drying tears, the God that is able to make crooked pathways straight, the God that is able to carry you up the rough side of the mountain. If you don't have that relationship with God, then you are prone to worry. And I'm afraid, Reverend, that even there's a whole lot of folk that claim to be bought by the crucified one's blood, who claim to make Jesus the center of their life. They still are the biggest worry warts that we will see. What is it, my brothers and sisters? What is it that causes you and I to worry unnecessarily? And when we worry, to not understand, it's not effective at all. What is the solution? What do we do? Well, I'm glad you asked that question. Friend, the book of Luke, in that 12th chapter of the book of Luke, at the 22nd verse, we find the following. And I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Version of the Sacred Writ. You may read from whatever translation you have, but this is what it says. And listen carefully, you worry warts. He said to his disciples, therefore, this is Jesus talking, therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, or about your body, what you will wear. For life is more than food, and the body more than clothing. Consider the ravens. They neither sow nor reap. They have neither storehouse nor barn, and yet God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? If then you are not able to do so small a thing as that, why do you worry about the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon, in all his glory, was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today, and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, you of little faith? And do not keep striving for what you are to eat and what you are to drink. And do not keep worrying, for it is the nations of the world that strive after these things. And your Father knows that you need them. Instead, strive for his kingdom, and these things will be given to you as well. Oh God, who sits high and reaches low, please, Lord, touch this word that it might resound within the very fibers of our being. That person that is worrying right now, free them, liberate them from their worries, and help them to know the ineffectiveness of worrying. Oh God, hear us now in Jesus' name. Amen. My brothers and sisters, this text that I've read is the solution to your worrying. It's better than taking a bunch of pills. It's better than drowning yourself in alcohol. It's better than finding all kind of reckless behavior. It's better than isolating yourselves from your fellow brothers and sisters. It is the only way that you and I can get past this dilemma of worrying. I've already tried to paint the picture for you by telling you the problems of worrying. I've already tried to set forth for you the ineffectiveness of worrying, that you can do nothing. The text says Jesus has commanded you and I should not worry. Oh, how can we say we trust God through Jesus Christ? But when we run into a little difficulty, you and I start becoming worry warts. You and I continue to worry about things we have no power over. Worrying, my friends, will send you to an early grave. I believe this is why Jesus was talking to those disciples and all those who were listening to him on that Sermon on the Mount. He was trying to help them to understand. And he speaks to you and I today that worrying will only put you in an early grave. You and I must cultivate a way to combat worrying. Well, the first thing you must do, and I said it earlier, you must have a relationship with God. There's too many of us out here that think we can do this thing all by ourselves. We think that we can do everything in and of ourselves, but the Proverbs tell us to trust and lean not on your own understanding. But if you trust in God in all your ways, he will lead you and guide you and direct you and take you out of the camp of worrying so that you will be able to have a calm, peaceful night. And so you must cultivate your relationship to God. The second thing, my brothers and sisters, you must turn it all over to the Lord. 1 Peter 5:7 tells us to cast all your worries upon him. He will take care of you. I'm so glad that I can cast all my worries on the Lord. I'm so glad that Peter was speaking what Jesus had told him to tell all the folk that he would preach to. Someone out here listening under the sound of my voice, you need to start casting your worries on the Lord. Don't run to the root lady. Don't run to the fortune teller. Cast your cares, cast your worries on him who is able to do anything and everything but fail. Oh, I know there's some saints out there who were pushed up against the wall, but you threw all your cares on the Lord, and somehow in the midst of heartache and heartbreak, he made a way out of no way. Oh, the prophet Isaiah said, before they have called, I will have answered. The Lord already knows your predicament, and all you have to do is lean on his everlasting arms. And so, my brothers and sisters, first thing I say, you got to cultivate that relationship with God. You who may have been running from the Lord, you who have thought you're big and bad enough to do it by yourself, you who think that you're able to take the licking and keep on ticking by yourself, you need to cultivate a relationship with God. Second thing, as I said, in that 1 Peter text, cast all your worries, cast all your cares upon him, and he will take care of you. The third thing, my brothers and sisters, which is one that all of us must continue to cultivate, is a consecrated prayer life. Oh, I'm just foolish enough to believe, my brothers and sisters, that prayer still matters. I'm just foolish enough to believe that prayer can still rescue you out of the doldrums. I'm still foolish enough to believe that prayer can move mountains. I'm still foolish enough to believe that prayer will make a way out of nowhere. And the good news, Kevin, is that even if prayer doesn't move what you want, it will move you on the inside. It will help you able to weather the storm, and you will then be able to take that licking and keep on ticking. Oh, I wish there was someone praying with me today. We don't have to worry. There's nothing effective about worry. Jesus commands us not to worry. If you have a little bit of faith, God will do the rest. If you just trust him a little bit, God will do the rest. Now, to be sure, it's not a quick fix all the time, my brothers and sisters. Sometimes you have to moan a little bit. Sometimes you have to bother the Lord. You remember the parable that Jesus gave of the opportune widow who appeared before the landlord, who said, I don't fear God or man. And she kept on bothering him, kept on knocking on the door. And he said, I'm not going to do what she wants. I'm not going to do it. I'm large and in charge. But she didn't give up. She kept on knocking on the door. And too many of y'all throw in the towel when your blessing is about to come down on you. And she kept on knocking. And finally, that wicked man said, I fear neither man nor God. But this woman, and I'm going to paraphrase a little bit here. This woman is bugging me so much. I'm going to get rid of her. I want to just do what she asks. And that's how our God is. The God that I serve and preach about every Sunday can only stand to hear God's children cry so long. He can only see your pillow drenched in tears so long. If you keep on staying on your knees, if you keep on lifting holy hands to God, if you keep on praying until something happens, the Lord will make a way out of no way. The Lord will pick you up when you're broken down. The Lord can turn you around in the midst of your heartbreak. The Lord can handle COVID. The Lord can handle repressive legislation. The Lord can handle wicked lying politicians. The Lord can make a way out of nowhere. Oh, I'm so glad this morning that I don't have to worry about a thing. I wasn't always like that, Kevin, but one day I realized I didn't worry, nothing would happen. All my worrying, like Jesus said, wouldn't change anything. The birds fly and they eat well. The lilies grow and they're beautiful. Jesus will take care of his own. Oh, if you believe you're a child of the Most High King, he will pick you up when you fall down. He will be your bridge over troubled water. He will give you strength when you don't have any. He will fight your battles. Oh, I know there's somebody who can testify. They said you weren't going to make it. They said you weren't going to be nobody. They said you didn't have a chance on that job. You were worrying, but you decided one night to take your burdens to the Lord and leave them there. When you take your burdens to the Lord, God will take care of you. Oh, is anybody in the house today can say the Lord made a way out of no way? The Lord fixed it when it was broken. The Lord made my enemies my footstool. The Lord fixed it when it was broken. Don't worry, it's not effective. Jesus said, trust him. Don't worry, my brothers and sisters. You can't change anything by worrying. All you can do is make yourself sick. Jesus said, I want you to be healthy. I want you to be whole. But someone out there today needs to know worrying won't do it for you, my brothers and sisters. Worrying is ineffective. The only thing is the fervent, effectual prayers of the righteous. And you and I know, if you don't know, I'm here to tell you, prayer works. Prayer will change things. Prayer will turn you from a worry wart to a faith warrior. And all we have to do is put our hands in the hand that will never let you go. We let go of God, God will never let us go. If you trust and never doubt, the Lord will surely bring you out. Seek ye first the kingdom of heaven, and all these other things will be added to you. Worrying is ineffective. Trust God. Trust God. God will never let you down. Amen. Amen.
Amen. What a timely word in this season when a lot of us choose to worry. We thank God for Pastor Kisner allowing the Lord to use him in a mighty way. Worry doesn't work, saints. It's ineffective. We got to trust God. We got to look to the hills. We have to, as Reverend Kisner said, we have to cast all of our cares on him, for he cares for us. So that helped me today, and I'm sure it helped somebody out there in virtual land. Somebody. We can't see you right now, but I know somebody is worrying. Somebody can't sleep, you can't eat, you're anxious about what tomorrow may bring. This may be the first time you've been reassured about Jesus, that if you put your hands in the Lord's hands, everything will be all right. In this moment, this is your opportunity, my brother or my sister. You've been trying to handle this all by yourself. You've given yourself to other devices and other alternatives, as Pastor lifted earlier. You do not have to do that any longer. Give it to Jesus. Say, Jesus, I'm tired. I can't do it by myself. I need you in my life. I need you to lead, guide, and direct me. And he's available right now. So why don't you come, my brother or my sister? The doors of the church are open. But better yet, if you have already accepted Jesus, but you're not plugged into a local church, why don't you join us here at Tabernacle? Our pastor would love to be your pastor. We would love to be your brothers and sisters in Christ. Doors of the church are open. Last call. You don't have to do this by yourself. You don't have to worry any longer. Why don't you say yes to the Master today? Why don't you say yes to Jesus and watch how he will bless you. Watch how he will handle your situation. Watch how he will give you abundant life. If you only say yes. And once again, we are available if you know Jesus, but you're not plugged into a local context. Last call. Last call. The doors of the church are open. And if you haven't accepted Jesus or you're not plugged in, make that call right now. 561-832-8338. 561-832-8338. Leave us a message and one of the clergy will return your call to have a conversation about salvation. Amen.
Amen. My brothers and sisters, we now come to a very important part of our service. And you know what I'm talking about, the giving of our tithes and our offerings. Amen, amen. Oh, yes, the Lord loveth a cheerful giver. And we are so blessed at Tabernacle. We have so many cheerful givers. In fact, several of them came by this week and they dropped off their offerings and we're so happy to see them. Just always have your mask, even in these times where it looks like it's getting better. Wear the mask. Call to make sure someone's there to receive your offering. But it is important that you keep on giving. We need your offerings and your tithes. And you see the platforms on the screen. Please, brothers and sisters, keep on giving. The Lord loves a cheerful giver. And again, we're trying to become a fully tithing church. You would be amazed at what will happen and the resources we'll have and the ministries we can conduct if we become a fully tithing church. And again, that's just one dime out of every dollar that you make. And the Lord will bless you. And again, it's not always money. The Lord will bless you in many ways. The Lord will never leave you in the lurch. You don't have to worry. When you do what thus saith the Lord, it will work itself out. I'm a living witness of what God will do. And so we urge you to please keep giving. And those of you that help giving us a little bit of more money on the outside, well, I got some funds from some folk in California who aren't even members of our church. They sent in checks because they like what we're trying to do. And so those of us on the home front, let's step up to the plate. Peace folk, please, we need your investment, but more importantly, we need your participation. We're still trying to get those Justice Team Ministry members, network members, I always mess that up, team members. We got three, we need four more. Please, this is a way to live out your ministry with purpose and passion. Justice is not free, and so invest in peace. We're doing some great things. We're coming up on a new peace year. We'll be having some new issues. You want to be a part. But please, if you haven't made your investment, get it in. It's important. All right? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for those who give so unselfishly of their very treasures. Now, God, we ask that you would take all of these offerings, that through your wonderment, expand them so they may be used for the uplifting of your kingdom. Bless each and every individual that is so faithful in their purposeful giving. And bless that one that had a fervent desire but could not fulfill it. Lord, bless them so that they too might join the aggregate of givers. Oh God, help us to use these resources wisely that you might gain greater glory. This is our prayer. Amen. All right, my brothers and sisters, we have had a wonderful time in the Lord. Hasn't this been a good day in the Lord? We've had a wonderful time praising, singing. Oh, God is so good to allow us, even in the midst of what's going on. We pray that the pandemic is getting a little better, but we got to still be careful, that Delta variant. And the key thing is to get vaccinated. Get vaccinated. There's a lot of misinformation going on. If you can't get the vaccine, call us. We'll help you get it. But we want to get everyone. We're looking to try to open up the second Sunday in September. But we want everybody to be vaccinated. And so we urge you to keep prayerful, stay safe, and be careful. Now, prayer and praise every Wednesday, 6 o'clock virtual, Bible study Tuesday. We had a wonderful discussion this past Bible study. We need you to come out on Tuesday, 6 o'clock virtual. And then, of course, on Sunday, third Sunday, we look forward to having you worship with us and just have a good time in the Lord. It's wonderful, isn't it? July, here we are, summer in the midst of summer. And again, I want to just say, those of you that are taking your vacations, even in the midst of this COVID, there's safe ways to do it. Don't forget your church. Send your tithes and offerings. I want you to have those vacations, but don't forget your church. And again, let's keep our individuals that are mourning, particularly the loss of Brother Bernard Jones, our treasurer, keep her in prayer. And those who are looking at potential surgery, Reverend Matthews is looking at surgery. She's waiting to get a report about her blood test. But there's a lot of sick amongst us and those who are mourning. Let's keep them in prayer. Call somebody. Let them know you're thinking about them. All right? All right, let's prepare for our dismissal. Oh God, our God, our gracious God, you've allowed us to assemble one more time. And for this, we say thank you, thank you, thank you. Lord, your Son told us not to worry. And yet many of us still ride that worry train. Help us to get off and to stand on the platform of faith, and to know that you're a God that will never forsake or leave us. Prop us up on every leaning side. Give us the courage to be strong in the midst of heartache, heartbreak, and hardship. Help us in these perilous times, both politically and with this dreaded virus, to be strong and not to worry, to know that everything is and everything will be all right. And now may the love of our awesome, gracious, magnificent God, the peace of our risen Savior, Jesus, even the Christ, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, abide, reside, and preside over each and every one of you, henceforth, now, and forever. Amen, amen, amen. God bless you. See you next week.
Hello, saints. I want to remind you all that as you receive your electronic notice about our worship Sundays services on Sunday, we ask that you scroll down and make sure that you click on the Tab Kids link, because there are videos that will minister to them during this time of virtual worship. So once again, when you receive the email for our worship services on Sunday morning, make sure you scroll down to the Tab Kids link so that your children can worship as well.
It's to our God. Y'all know how we do it. Take it up and praise. It's to our God.
One accord.
Come on, say every praise.
Every praise.
It's to our God. I want everybody all over the world to sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah.
To our God.
Glory, hallelujah.
It's to our God.
Every praise.
Every praise.
Every praise.